Good afternoon, Hoosiers. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. Let me get straight to the lead. Tomorrow I will sign an executive order that will mandate that Hoosiers wear face coverings during specific times and in specific places. The effective start date will be this upcoming Monday, July 27th. We've arrived at this juncture because over the past several weeks, a few things have happened. There have been a rise in COVID-19 positivity across the state from a low of 3.6% just a month ago to where we find ourselves today with a 7-day average rate of just about 7%. Last couple days, it was closer to 8%. And as a lagging indicator, our overall hospitalization census has increased from about 600 a day near the end of June to about 800 where we are now. Also, some counties in the past that have never even been a blip on the radar screen for positive tests and in some cases reporting regular double-digit COVID-19 positive cases now. Counties like Clark and DuBois and Kosciuszko, Porter, Posey. And lastly, if you tune into national news, our surrounding states are all experiencing increases in positive cases as well. We have, as Hoosiers, worked very hard to get to where we are today. Businesses are open and operating at various levels of capacity. People are getting haircuts, myself included. A couple months ago, my wife threatened to cut my hair in my sleep if I didn't do it myself. We're eating in restaurants and we're working in all kinds of facilities, both large and small. And we want to keep it that way. We want businesses to stay open. We want more Hoosiers to continue this trend of going back safely to work. We don't want to dial it back or put it in reverse or, as some are, shutting down again. Face coverings can and will help us blunt this increase. It has in other places around the country, indeed around the world. And this is time sensitive now. It's that time of the year, after all, when schools are going back. This might be one of the most important reasons, when you really stop and think about it, for all of us to wear face coverings. We're asking our kids and their teachers to mask up. And our kids should not be getting mixed messages throughout the day. When they leave school grounds, they need to see that everyone is doing what they're doing, that best practices are best for all. By slowing or stopping, many times, the unknowingly transmission of COVID-19. Our order will require masks or face coverings for anyone 8 years or older while you are in public indoor spaces and commercial entities, when using public transportation or other vehicle services, and in outside public spaces when it's not possible to be socially or physically distanced from people who are not from the same household. And of course, a statewide mandate means we'll require mask use in schools. Members of the Indiana State Teachers Association ask that students in the sixth grade and above wear masks. We will apply mandatory mask wearing for students in the third grade and above. Faculty and staff, volunteers and others who may be in a school or for co-curricular or extracurricular activities, with exceptions for strenuous physical activities. The order will, of course, need to have exceptions. I fully realize that. For example, for medical purposes, exercising, and obviously eating and drinking. Now, I know not everyone will be supportive of this mandate. Compliance and enforcement are always in question. Our approach if you recall, since day one, since the very beginning of this pandemic, has been an approach of education, of appealing to one's civic duty and public good, you might even say public pride, in being part of the solution. And it will continue to be. So while not wearing a mask, when and where I just stated before, is a Class B misdemeanor, please know the masked police will not be patrolling Hoosier streets. When I asked you months ago to hunker down, you did. We did. And we slowed the spread. It's just factual. And we protected our hospitals from becoming overrun. And we managed our supplies and our supply chains. And as we've reopened segments of our economy, we knew cases would increase around the country and in Indiana. But we stuck laser focused on our four guiding principles. And while we have continued to fare better than many other states, now we have to hunker down in a different way, which is why wearing masks will become the fashion of the day. Again, it's just a fact. The simple act of covering our faces, as odd as it may feel, can help us prevent the transmission of the virus, which again is why this is the next prudent step that we as a state need to take. As educators across the state have worked to finalize their back-to-school plans, our health professions in particular have fielded many, many questions. There's a lot that continues to leave us with unknowns. But Dr. Box, Dr. Weaver, and Lori Ramsey, the registered nurse Dr. Box has brought on board to help directly work with schools, have all been talking to educators on a regular basis to answer questions and to respond to their concerns, and we'll continue to do this every day forward. How to prepare for a positive case in a school is a reoccurring theme, understandably so. Dr. Sullivan and Dr. Weaver have developed specific guidance, and I'll ask them to walk through that here in just a moment. But first, let me add a few more personal comments about school openings. First, there is no more important task before us than returning students safely to school for instruction. Our Back on Track plan states that schools may resume July 1. Staying in stage 4.5 for any period of time does not preclude schools from opening or require modification of their efforts. Second, as I stated this last week, and I want to say it again, I will not set a single start date for the entire state for schools to begin. This is up to your local school systems. School leaders have developed and adopted excellent return plans. I've read many of them, reviewed a lot of them, and I know educators and students alike are eager to get back at it, to see one another. We remembered how they were physically separated just months ago. There are hybrid approaches and face-to-face approaches, and we hope phased-in approaches, bringing the youngest back first. Some schools have decided to begin the academic year 100% virtual, and I respect that decision. And I hope it's only temporary. But I want school districts to be very mindful of what that decision means holistically for the family. Some families will not have childcare or another location for their child to go to have a good learning environment. So it's important, so important, for school districts that chose offering virtual education to also consider the impact on students and their families, and I know they will. Please consider opening your buildings and providing transportation for students who need a safe site to participate in their online learning while virtual learning is in session. Next, I want to encourage all schools, every one of them, to apply to the Pandemic FEMA Public Assistance Program to become eligible for reimbursement for supplies needed for safely reopening all of your facilities. The deadline to apply is July 31st, the end of this month, via directly the FEMA grants portal. Finally, let me just say that the Indiana Economic Development Corporation, in conjunction with Langham Logistics, estimates it will have delivered 1.1 million masks to 228 schools and school corporations by the end of this week. That means in the first 6 days, not weeks, days of this program, we have delivered more than half the total number of masks requested statewide. We are getting it done together. We expect that nearly all deliveries will be complete by August 7th. To assure you that we don't miss anyone, we'll post this information on our Back on Track website. So any school or school district that may not be on our list for whatever reason knows how to directly reach us. So with that, I'll now turn it over to Drs. Weaver, Sullivan, and Dan to elaborate and update us all on their areas of expertise. Dr. Weaver, over to you.
Thank you, Governor. I'd like to start first with a couple comments about masks. So physicians and other clinicians have worn masks for a long time to protect themselves and their patients. This is standard practice to help prevent the spread of disease. You wouldn't want to go into an operating room with a doctor that wasn't wearing a mask. While the guidance on masks has changed throughout this pandemic, there are a growing number of studies that support wearing cloth face coverings to help reduce the transmission of COVID-19. Wearing a mask can reduce the distance that droplets from a cough or sneeze can spread. Some studies have suggested that they can reduce the risk of transmission by up to 80%. I've been taking care of COVID patients in the emergency department for several months now. The majority of the time I wear my simple surgical mask, except for in high-risk situations where I wear an N95. I feel comfortable and confident that taking these precautions has protected me and my family. Over and over again, Dr. Mbox and I have talked about the importance of hand hygiene, social distancing, staying home when you are sick, and protecting those that are the most at risk. Wearing masks is yet another tool we have to protect each other. Our own data here in Indiana showed that close to 40% of people who were positive for COVID-19 did not have symptoms, which underscores the importance of wearing masks when in public. We've seen reports on how masks have helped prevent infections, including two hairdressers in Missouri who served nearly 140 clients. Both stylists were positive, but none of their clients got COVID. In another case, a COVID-positive person wore a mask on an international flight. None of the people sitting nearby that person tested positive. Face coverings do not result in carbon dioxide elevations or decreased oxygen. So once again, washing your hands, staying home if you're sick, practicing social distancing, and wearing masks will allow us to get back on track and safely return students to school in the fall. Dr. Sullivan is here to talk to you more about schools.
Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Jennifer Sullivan, Secretary of the Indiana Family and Social Services Administration. Today, I'm here with 5 months of our agency's experience guiding Indiana's childcare system through COVID, but more importantly, as a pediatrician, the daughter of educators, and a mom of two boys, one heading back to an Indiana college campus for a second year, and the other looking forward to his freshman year of high school at one of Indiana's public schools, both experiencing healthy amounts of eagerness and uncertainty that have become so common for all of us. It goes without saying, there are many ongoing challenges confronting our state's COVID response. One of the most important is continuing to provide a high-quality education to our more than 1 million children, with a special focus on children in low-income families, those without resources for remote learning, and children with disabilities. Most have been without the structure of a classroom and access to many enriching life experiences since mid-March. And while some students have responded well to e-learning instruction, others are struggling. Indiana must offer high-quality options for students to learn. The idea of returning to the classroom is daunting for some, while others are eager to return. We also know that school is essential for the well-being of children and their families in even deeper ways than education. Food security, safety, mental health, and social-emotional learning are critical to building and maintaining the fabric of society. It is a privilege to work across agencies to support the governor and the priority he places on children's health and well-being. So I'm going to start with my mom voice. What we do now to decrease the community prevalence of COVID is what gets as many of our kids back to school as possible. This means you. Put your mask on. Limit large gatherings. Keep a physical distance of 6 feet from anyone you don't live with. Keep surfaces and your hands clean. Not only will this limit viral transmission, it will build confidence in families to return their children to school, and will show teachers and school staff that we care about them. Indiana flattened the curve for healthcare, and now we flatten it for kids. So on to the pediatrician voice, which is a little nicer. When we flattened the curve this spring with a massive, disruptive shutdown, we didn't know nearly as much about this virus as we do now. So we had to shut down to build up our healthcare system reserve and research what we are dealing with. You did that. Now that we are opening back up, we have seen an anticipated rise in cases, but this doesn't have to keep going. In order to avoid any backtracking in our opening plan, we have to aggressively protect each other with these simple measures, and we can. Childcare has been an essential service for the duration of the COVID pandemic. Today, only 16 of only 4,000 Indiana childcares are closed due to a teacher or child with COVID. The guidelines and supports that are in place and that our 29,575 independent, caring, and diverse early childhood educators are following in all corners of Indiana have allowed for ongoing availability of childcare despite difficult circumstances. Applying these lessons learned to the school setting is key, in addition to the work that individual Hoosiers will do. Schools should use these interventions to minimize the spread of the virus. Space desks as far as possible facing in the same direction. Cohort younger students into pods. Hand wash and disinfect frequently. Plan schedules so that a minimum number of students are close contacts. Do not conduct birthday parties or other events that put students in close contact. Isolate and send home any person who develops symptoms. Here's how the school mask mandate will work. Masks are required at school, and the details for those guidelines are as follows. Students grade 3 through 12 are required to wear a face covering at all times in a school setting, except for the following. If a school classroom can be configured such that all students and instructors are at least 3 to 6 feet apart. During outdoor recess, where proper social distancing measures are enforced. When deemed necessary by a school official for instructional purposes. And individual discretion for students with an IEP or 504 learning plan will be continued. Regardless of age, all students should wear a face covering while on a school bus. A note on mask requirements and age. The American Academy of Pediatrics says it is safe for children down to the age of 2 to wear face coverings. I highly recommend doing just that in public spaces and in the childcare or school setting when at all feasible. Emerging literature suggests that as children get older, they are more likely to spread the coronavirus, so face covering mandate kicks in at 8 or 3rd grade. Faculty and staff are required to wear a face covering at all times in a school setting when interacting with their colleagues and students. Instructors in classrooms with at least 6 feet between their instructional area and students are not required to wear a mask while social distancing is observed. Another big concern is how to deal with positive cases in the classroom and how decisions should be made about circumstances that warrant closure and when to reopen. ISDH and FSSA have developed additional specific guidance and a series of evidence-based individual case scenarios to guide positive cases. Pods of kids that move through the day together will allow small groups to isolate rather than an entire classroom or schools to close. The threshold to close a pod is 1 case, and to close a classroom is 2. This is what we have successfully done in the childcare setting. There aren't many more compelling things or duties that we share that are more important than setting up the next generation for success. I'm proud of Hoosiers for setting aside our differences to embrace an evidence-based approach to do just that. Dr. Weaver, I'll send it back to you to walk through an example of a case scenario.
Thank you. So as Dr. Sullivan mentioned, our schools are going out of their way to space desks further apart, assign seating, create one-way traffic patterns in hallways, and cohort their students. All these efforts will help protect students and teachers, and they will make it easier to conduct contact tracing if a case does appear in a school. We understand that parents and families have lots of questions about what will happen when a child or teacher tests positive, and we have some guidance for that. When a student or adult tests positive in a classroom, we'll identify who spent more than 15 minutes within 6 feet of the person for the 48 hours prior to symptoms onset. In the case of a person with no symptoms but tested positive, we would look to the 48 hours prior to the date that the test was taken. This is consistent with what we do with contact tracing now. Close contacts will be asked to quarantine at home for 14 days and will be monitored and guided by the local health department and the state's centralized contact tracing center. If any close contacts test positive, the process begins again. If cohorting and assigned seating has not been possible, such as for pre-kindergarten through second grade, an entire classroom may need to quarantine. As mentioned, if more than one student tests positive in a classroom, the entire classroom should quarantine for 14 days. No threshold has been set for if an entire school should close. If a school has multiple positive cases, officials should work with the state and local health department on what next steps to take. Siblings of a positive case should quarantine if they are considered a close contact. Now, let me walk you through a scenario. This is a simplified example of what may occur. So let's say the blue student tests positive. The school will look carefully at the student's schedule and assign seats to help identify those students who are within 6 feet for the greater than 15 minutes, and those students will quarantine. Many schools also choose to assign pods. The pods cohort students into small groups that may play together, sit together, eat together, and that further reduces the risk of transmission. In this case, the blue positive student was only in close contact with the students in her pod on the playground. And also, several of those students were sitting next to her in class. Therefore, only a small number of students will need to quarantine. So, now on to the daily data. All of these steps are especially important as we continue to see the number of cases in Indiana increase. Today, we reported 763 additional cases of COVID-19 in Indiana. That brings us to 58,673 Hoosiers who are confirmed to have had COVID. Over the last 7 days, 5,345 Hoosiers have tested positive for COVID. For the same period in June, we saw just under 2,900 cases. We also have seen 2,666 Hoosiers die from this illness and have another 197 who are believed to have died of COVID based on a physician's clinical assessment of their symptoms. Our ICU and ventilator capacity remain fairly consistent. As of today, nearly 37% of ICU beds and more than 82% of ventilators are available statewide. And we continue to increase testing throughout the state with more than 200 sites available. As of today, more than 654,000 Hoosiers have been tested for COVID-19. That's up from more than 586,000 a week ago. All of these data points are critical to informing the four guiding principles we're following to reopen the state. Those are the number of hospitalized patients, the capacity to treat a surge, the ability to test all Hoosiers who are symptomatic, and the ability to contact trace all cases. As I mentioned, our ICU and ventilator capacity are holding steady, which means we currently have capacity for severely ill COVID patients, but we know that can change quickly, especially as we see more patients admitted to the hospital. Our hospitalization numbers remain significantly higher than they were in late June, and we have seen the number of daily inpatient admissions for COVID jump again. Our positivity rate stands at 9%, which also has increased from early July. We have increased testing capacity significantly in the last few weeks, but we also recognize that national demand for testing has created a strain on the supply chain, similar to what we saw back in March and April. Indiana has come a long way since our first case in March, but the challenges remain. This pandemic is far from over, and we have more work to do. I'd like to now turn it over to Dr. Dan to give an update on the nursing home dashboard.
Hi, I'm Dan Orsiniak, Chief Medical Officer for the Family and Social Service Administration. I just want to take a couple minutes to give a brief update on the development of our long-term care COVID dashboard. As you recall, the first step in that process was to ask facilities to go back to the start of this pandemic and to collect all of the information around residents and staffs that had positive COVID tests or had died. Now, the deadline for this data submission was July 14th, and as promised, we will make this interim data file public by the end of the day. This file will show you, by facility name, how many cases and deaths a facility had in residence and how many staff they had that tested positive. I want to highlight a couple of key numbers. Of the 756 facilities who we asked to submit data, 630, or 83%, have done so. As of Friday, 130 facilities have not yet submitted their data. This is not to say that they have never submitted data to the state. Rather, this means that they have not yet submitted this historical data in the new data format that we require for our dashboard. We are calling all of these facilities and will troubleshoot and work with them to overcome the problems that may have prevented them from getting the data submitted. We're pushing for 100% of facilities to submit their data before the release of the public dashboard, and we'll continue to work with them to help them do so. This is a mandate, and as such, they are required to do so or will face potential penalties. What this aggregate data is going to show is that since March 1st, there have been 1,390 reported deaths in long-term care residents. This represents 53% of the state total deaths and is 128 more than what is currently listed on the long-term care data chart of our dashboard. Because this data is more comprehensive than what we currently have up, we're going to remove the aggregate data in the table on the dashboard. In addition, facilities have reported 5,867 long-term care residents who have tested positive for COVID, or about 11% of the state total. This is 34 more than is currently listed on our dashboard. Now, the reason these numbers are different is that facilities have gotten better at reporting, and we've gotten better at collecting the data. We've also made it easier for facilities by giving them better instructions and more time to go back and identify cases. And we've enhanced our agency data collection and analysis by improving the submission portal and strengthening our in-house data teams. I will also mention that when you look at the data, every resident case does not necessarily correlate with an outbreak in that facility. Many facilities admit patients from a hospital who were there because they had COVID and now require a nursing home. While these cases would count as a positive resident case for that facility, they would not be from spread within that facility. We're also reporting for the first time numbers around long-term care staff. Since March 1st, facilities have reported 2,521 infections in staff and 12 total deaths. Couple points to mention here. Because there are so few staff deaths, to protect their privacy, we will not list totals on staff deaths for each facility. And also because staff may work at multiple facilities, it is possible that a case may have been reported involving a staff by more than one nursing home, which would make the total number of staff cases likely that is on this interim data likely higher than the actual total. As we get data from facilities who have not yet submitted, we will provide an update to this historical file each Monday until the dashboard is publicly available. We anticipate the release of the public dashboard within 3 weeks. This dashboard will include aggregate numbers, but will also allow users to search by individual facility name or to locate a facility on a statewide map. Because of our enhanced data collection tools, We will better be able to verify reported cases across multiple databases, and we'll be able to develop additional features in the weeks after the initial release. These may include demographic data, data on recovery, and visualizations of outbreaks for individual facilities. We will keep you updated on the dashboard and its progress as we go along. I should mention also that the data that we're providing today in the dashboard does not change our requirements for facilities to continue to provide a daily report on their COVID status to residents and their representatives. Facilities also will need to continue to report their aggregate numbers to CMS. And lastly, with all the talk on masks, I wanted to give a brief personal story, I think, on the importance of wearing a mask. So a few weeks ago, while working in the emergency department, I had a pretty significant COVID exposure. Without getting too much into the details, I had a patient who had a massive coughing spell that literally spewed moisture directly in my face while I was doing a COVID test. And what became very clear very quickly, especially as my glasses fogged, is that the only thing that was separating me from millions of airborne particles of coronavirus were my glasses and my face mask. Now, after this exposure, I quarantined myself for 2 weeks and got tested, great testing site at ISDH. My test was negative, and I never developed symptoms. So while a face mask is not foolproof, and in a similar setting, and I would have been better off with an N95 mask or a face shield, I am convinced that the only difference between me being homesick, or worse, in a hospital sick, and me being here today is that I had on a face mask. So please, please wear a mask. It might just save your life.
Thank you, Dr. Dan. Pretty compelling way to close. One last thing, Rachel, before we move on to the Q&A portion of the program. The Economic Recovery Committee will be putting out plans next week that we'll talk about. It'll be led by Lieutenant Governor Crouch, of course, but it'll talk about plans for restoration and preservation, programs for cultural and arts and tourism. Property owners will be very interested in this, community events, anything that's been adversely affected by COVID-19. And so tune in next week, same time, same channel, and Lieutenant Governor Crouch and I will roll those plans out. Rachel.
Steve with KPC Media.
Good afternoon, Steve.
Good afternoon. How are you doing today?
Good. How are you?
Good. Two quick questions to squeeze in here. Governor Holcomb, with poll showing mask usage has been around 40%, and certainly past polling we've done in Northeast Indiana has kind of reflected that. Can you talk to me a little bit about how you think the mandate is going to boost that number? And then for Dr. Weaver and others who may be there, while we've seen upticks in cases and positivity in hospitalizations, daily death rate has been the one metric that's continued to be going in a good direction in decreasing. I know part of that has to do with getting a handle on nursing home outbreaks earlier in the pandemic, but I was wondering if you'd be able to just talk a little bit about how the experience and some of the treatment options have improved to perhaps allow better care for the people who do end up with serious symptoms and cases.
I suspect, Steve, that both of the docs will want to chime in here on your second question, but it kind of tees up my personal response to your first question, and that is not once, not one doctor, not one scientist, not one statistician, no one serious about slowing the spread of COVID-19 has ever brought up a poll to me or a number or how something registers. And I don't think it's because they know that I would not react very favorably to that. This is not about polling. This is about slowing the spread. And hopefully for folks who don't subscribe to science, the facts will prove that their behavior, our behavior, will get us through this safer and sooner. And with that, I'll turn it over to the more qualified medical clinical perspectives.
So while we have learned a lot more about this disease, and I think that we learn more every day as more studies come out to teach us more about how we should care for it. That being said, there is still no cure. And I really feel what we're seeing with the deaths is all the work that we have done together to socially distance, to wear masks, the hand hygiene, and older people who are more vulnerable, that we're making sure that we're doing everything that we can to protect them. As we see the cases rise and the hospitalizations, it is a worry. That's the last thing any of us would want to see, is those number of deaths start to go back up again.
I would absolutely agree with Dr. Weaver's comments. We see death increases later. Those don't happen at the same time as increased number of cases or as increased number of hospitalizations. And so it is still our fear that we'll see that lagging indicator later. But we certainly do know more about treatment options for this disease process in the clinical setting as well, and hope to continue to implement those as we move forward. As far as the first question, if I may weigh in, sir, I think back to one of the best harm reduction strategies in our country's history, which is the Click It or Ticket campaign, for those of you who are old enough like I to remember that. The addition of enforcement to seatbelt usage increased Americans' propensity to put a seatbelt on in less than 16 months from 18% to 88%. And so the mandate, we believe, will help to change behavior for those who might be on the fence and help others understand how important that is to do.
Yeah, it's just that basic. I mean, you have schooled me on this. It is sunscreen, it is cigarette filters, it is seatbelts, it is you name it, but it's all about, as you say, reducing the harm or the potential harm, and the facts speak for themselves, and they do with masks. And what the thing is, Steve, I don't want to be in the situation a week from now. So we're getting very close to, if we look at the numbers, if we look at all the data, I don't want to be in a situation where I say, boy, I wish we would have put a statewide mask mandate in place. I've heard from enough community leaders. I've heard from enough businesses. I've heard that want to stay open. I've heard from enough local officials, some of which have gone there already. And so we've got kind of this hodgepodge effort around the state of Indiana. But as I mentioned at the outset, we're now starting to see double digits in counties that just never experienced it before. So it has spread. And I've taken note of my gubernatorial cohorts around the country who said, I wish I would have done this 3 weeks ago. And so I don't want us to be 3 weeks from now where they were or are right now. So this is just yet another piece of the puzzle that we need to put in place to do all that we can, all of us.
Sherry with the Indianapolis Star.
Afternoon, Sherry.
Good afternoon, Governor. I am going to ask you one tough question is, do you wish you had done this a week or two ago when a lot of people were asking you to do it? And I think maybe the cry just got louder and louder. And then this is perhaps a question for Dr. Weaver. If you could talk a bit about where we are in terms of contact tracing. I know Dr. Box mentioned that either last week or the week before. Are we doing about the same? Are we still having trouble getting people in a timely fashion after their positive tests?
I'll go with the first question first. I don't want to sound cavalier, Sherry, or just try to prove myself right, but it's not that the voices got louder, it's the numbers got bolder. And we look at these numbers, and we would have done it a week ago had I felt and the team felt that we needed to do it a week ago or 2 weeks ago. So we're not, we're courageous enough around here to do the right thing. It's somewhat liberating, by the way. I don't want us to be in that situation 4 weeks from now. And so very comfortable. Had I wished, Sherry, that I didn't see some of the pictures that your publication has put out, where I would have hoped 80% plus would have been masked up, and it was more like less than 20% masked up. And I will confess to you that after seeing some of those pictures speak 1,000 words. And so when you see those pictures aligned with the numbers, I've seen this movie before. I've seen it around the country. I know how it ends. And we're trying to change that ending for real people. I forgot her second question.
Contact tracing.
Contact tracing, yes.
So we're still moving forward ahead with our contact tracing, contacting people within 48 to 72 hours. Of course, they have to answer the phone call, so please do so. We're going to hire more. We know that as we go back into school, both K through 12 and also in higher education, that the need for contact tracers is going to go up. Additionally, we work with our local health departments on them doing contact tracing, and I know the universities are also looking to have contact tracers as well. So we're discussing all the details, exactly how that all meshes and works together. But I think it's going to really work well. It really is a team effort.
It is a team effort, and I should just chip in here that Sherry, we have obviously taken in a lot of input. I spoke to Hoosier, the nation's Surgeon General, Jerome Adams, and passed by some thoughts. He was in complete agreement with this approach at this time, understood we didn't want to look back with regret. And so it's understanding what's going on. That's why I said at the outset as well, it's just not what's happening in our counties, all 92 of them, but it's also what's happening around us. I think you'll see some other governors move on this as well.
John with Wave TV.
Good afternoon, John.
Good afternoon, Governor. Can you hear me?
Loud and clear.
All right, very good. So many people dialed in on the Indy 500 and Kentucky Derby down here. With the new level of 25% of fans at Indy, what can Louisville learn from the preparations at the Motor Speedway as far as the limits on seats and the infield and vendors and the restaurants, 25% still a lot of people, whether it's up Speedway or Triple Downs?
Well, they can buy more property. This is the IMS is a massive, you know, it's a 250-acre spread of property. They have an 88-page plan. They can learn a lot by their plan. So they have obviously a lot of space. You can fit inside the track, the Indy 500 track, not the Derby, but you can fit inside our track, the Yankee Stadium, the Rose Bowl, Churchill Downs. You can fit the Colosseum in Rome. You can fit Vatican City all inside. So they have the ability to number to meet the metrics, so to speak. They can space out. They can mask up, which they've said, and follow the guidance. And so I think they could learn a lot from a lot of different events, and we'll be happy to share that information, but it's all detailed in 88 plus pages.
David Williams, Wish TV.
Hello, David.
Good afternoon, Governor and Drs. Weaver and Sullivan. Good to see you. Two questions. How long will the mask mandate last? And I understand our state's fight against COVID is ever changing minute by minute. There are states including California, Nevada, Texas, Florida, and our neighbor to the north, Michigan, that are actually reversing opening plans. I know we are paused at stage 4.5, but are we headed in the direction to reverse our reopening plans?
That's, David, what I want to avoid and why we're taking this step right now is so that we don't have to. We have so many of our businesses that are back online. We're seeing positive trends. I need to get Fred Payne up next week to give you an update on our employment numbers. But we're moving in the right direction. We want to continue to move in the right direction. And so that's why, as you look around the country, we're not all in the same place, but we could end up in the same place. And so that's why these practices are being rolled out. What was the first? David, what was your first question? I'll give you a technical answer to a technical question. As long as they need to, but when we start to see the arrows that are going in the wrong direction turn and start going in the right direction, then we can start to adjust our actions. And so, look, when you look at these other states that say, I wish I would have done this 3 weeks ago, when they were actually in a little worse position as we are right now, I don't want to get there. I want to avoid that. I want to stay open. I want to continue to not just make sure that it's safe to go back, whether it's school or work, but that we have the ability to get our economy still moving. This is about lives and livelihoods, as we always talk about. And this is a step in that direction.
Nikki Kelly, the Fort Wayne Journal-Gazette.
Afternoon, Nikki.
Hi. I just want to say really quickly, first, we'd love it if you maybe had some additional briefings now that we're seeing an increase again. So just a quick hope from the press. And then also, I wanted to chat with the doctors a little. A lot of people are talking about how low the mortality rate and our death rate is down. I wanted you to talk about why is it we should care. Basically, it seems like people only care if someone's dying. And so I wanted you to talk maybe about long-term health impacts or things like that.
How much time you got, Nikki?
Well, one of the things that we're learning about this virus is that death is not the only outcome that we're trying to avoid. There are other potential long-term complications that are evolving in the literature. The impact on children, with some so far relatively rare, but still potentially life-altering complications. The increased risk of blood clots. There's just continuing to go down the list of not just what we call mortality, but morbidity. Mortality is just the tip of the iceberg of a disease process. The death rate, obviously, is the part that got our attention. But the underlying cohort of individuals that have had the disease take a long time to recover, may have long-lasting effects. We're still learning those things. And so protecting the general public, regardless of their age, from contracting the disease in the first place is our absolute goal.
I would just add from my standpoint that no death is acceptable, and that really that should be our goal, that we get to that point. We've also seen an increase in the younger generation with positive cases, which we know do have a lower death rate, but do also get severe illness and are in the hospital and sick. And even worse, our big worry is that are they right now spreading it to their older adult loved ones, and are we going to start seeing the outcome of that here in the next couple of weeks?
Candy with the DuBois County Herald.
Candy, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me?
I can, yes.
Okay, I have two questions, if that's okay.
Absolutely.
So DuBois County, my county is not one of the most heavily populated counties in the state.
Yeah.
But as of now, we're like number one in the state for the number of positive cases per capita in the last 7 days. They're calling my county a hotspot. And I'm assuming you know this because you of course mentioned my county when you were referring to the mask mandate that you're doing.
Yes.
So I'm wondering if the state is doing anything to reach out to this area, to my area, to kind of help or assist with this situation, or is it really still on my local officials to kind of fend for ourselves and figure this out? The second question is when you mentioned your mask mandate, you mentioned that there would be no mask police in doing this, which I understand, but are you ready to put some sort of enforcement behind it if the public doesn't comply? That's it.
Thank you, Candy. Your first question, absolutely we're in contact with your county, and will continue to be. Have from the start, from the local health department to access and availability to local school corporations. It just so happens that I was on the in communication with one of your elected officials last night, three or four times after 10 p.m. So we are very connected on the ground through our various agencies and, by the way, myself directly. You've got good local leadership there. It is absolutely, when we say we're in this together, it requires us to be in this together. And it requires that partnership, and it requires making sure folks are aware how lethal COVID-19 really is. And so absolutely, we'll continue to work with you. When I said we don't have any mask police, we are going to continue, along with our partnerships locally, to try to appeal to Hoosiers to do the right thing. And we have sought this through education. We have a Homeland Security, Department of Homeland Security, led by Steve Cox, who is working with local law enforcement agencies. We have our state police, obviously working with to try to encourage and appeal for folks to do the right thing. We don't want it to get to the point where misdemeanors come into play. They have around other states, but we don't think we're there yet. We're hoping as the cases increase, we can dial back that kind of cavalier behavior instead of dialing back, going back to work.
Abdul Hakeem Shabazz, Indy Politics.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Governor. How are you doing today?
I'm doing good. And no, it's not going to be Abduliana.
Not a problem, Governor. Two things. Number one, why wait until Monday for the executive order? Why not earlier to prevent the spread of COVID-19? And number two, what about people who are just hard-headed and won't wear a mask, period? There was a protest rally at the State House, I won't say this past Sunday, folks saying they're not going to wear a mask. How do you convince people that just won't listen, I guess, without a misdemeanor or some sort of criminal penalty?
It's going to take a lot of us. Yes, there are folks who are hard-headed, and yes, and by the way, I am encouraged that from the local level to the state level to the national level, hopefully there is one message being received. Even the president said yesterday that this is going to get worse across the country. Said it was a patriotic duty or action to wear a mask, to physically distance yourself. So having that alignment, I hope that message is being not just heard, but it's being consumed. And so will there be hard-headed people? Yes, I get it. This is nothing that I wanted to do. This is not about what I want to do or wished would be. This is what the reality is. And so I would just ask people to recognize that the sooner that we get through this, the better, and it will be because we were all in it together. What was his first question? Abdul, what was your first? Oh, why wait till Monday? Thank you. Well, we're giving people, I'm going to sign the order tomorrow. We're putting the finishing touches on it tonight. We want to give people time to adjust. Hopefully the word spreads throughout the state a lot faster than the virus. And this gives communities an opportunity to prepare. Again, they both said it. This is face covering. So, you know, I always talk about mask up, but it can be a scarf, it can be cloth, it can be a t-shirt tied. So when you're in those spaces, what we're trying to do is very simply, this is elementary, stop the transmission of COVID-19, whether you know you have it or not.
Amanda with the Warsaw Times Union.
Good afternoon, Amanda.
Hi, Governor. Thanks for taking my question.
Sure.
As discussed today, school corporations around the state are rolling out their reopening plans for August, and those plans include automatic quarantine times for students who are exposed to a symptomatic child for up to 14 days. I think most parents of school-aged children are confused and worried about contact exposure and how frequently their child will get sent home. What protections are in place against being fired if you miss work to care for your child who is sent home? And do you think employers should prepare guidelines for how to handle these situations? And lastly, what can you say to the working parents who are feeling stressed about the looming school year and the possibility of missing work 2 weeks at a time, perhaps several times during the school year?
School protections and job protections are in place as part of the contact tracing protocol, and we are working to strengthen those as well. I completely, as a parent myself, understand the stresses that occur when you think about a continuous school year with the potential for several interruptions. We want to make sure that we have a package in place to support those families. And honestly, the work that we do now to make sure that we have as few cases in schools as possible, we'd like to actually have that be zero so that everyone can stay in school continuously after we go back safely. But really understanding the realities of how that works, making sure that we have ongoing support from the federal level for waivers that are in place for many of our programs, to have those in place during the school year will help us get through this together.
You want to talk just a second about, I mean, if you do, if you're not at work, if you have Medicaid, you are eligible, so you're not going to lose health coverage, because that can be a stressor too, but, and a lot of people think they will, and that's not the case.
Absolutely. Thanks for bringing that up again. Since the beginning of the pandemic, we've had waivers in place for all of our eligibility-based services. So Medicaid, the Healthy Indiana Plan, SNAP, TANF, Child Care Development Fund, any of those support services that have an income level, it's called eligibility, those have all been placed on hold. So that as you work your way through the different phases of opening, having going back to work, maybe having to go back home for a couple of weeks, those are irrelevant for your eligibility for those programs. And we will keep those in place for as long as the emergency is extended. So that's one less thing that Hoosier families have to worry about, is those support services that are in place for themselves and for their kids.
Whitney Downard, CNHI.
Sure. Good afternoon, Whitney.
Good afternoon. I just have one really quick question to end us for Dr. Dan. I was reviewing some of the long-term care newsletters, and there was a letter in April for nursing homes accepting COVID-positive patients, and it said nursing homes are expected to. Can you kind of clarify whether or not nursing homes had to accept COVID positive patients in Indiana? And if so, did you guys track which homes accepted those patients and what those outcomes might have been?
Sure, I'll try to answer that. So there's not a mandate that they have to accept a new patient from a hospital. They've always had the discretion and continue to have the discretion on who they admit, because every nursing home is going to be in a different situation. There are nursing homes who right now have dedicated wings for folks with COVID, and we have, through our agency and FSSA and the health department, continued to provide ways to support them so that they can take new admissions, but there's never been a mandate that they must take a new admission.
Our final question is from Justin Keel with the Westville Indicator.
Good afternoon, Justin. Thanks for joining us.
Good afternoon, Governor. We've seen posts on Facebook circulating around about masks decreasing oxygen intake, increasing toxin inhalation, shutting down the body's immune system, and increasing risk of the virus. What would the doctor say to the people who have shared these posts, and what steps is your administration taking to prevent misinformation about masks and the virus?
Go get them.
Well, I hope that all of you know an old crusty surgeon. Old crusty surgeons have worn masks for 12 to 18 hour cases in a row for complex ways that they save our lives, working on your brain, working on your heart, working on all kinds of other things. Masks have holes in them, so fabric is not solid. And the molecules that go back and forth across those masks are smaller than the holes in the fabric. That doesn't matter if it's a cloth mask or an N95, or an N95 with a mask over the top. You can breathe in and out with those just like you can without one on. So no worries about toxins. No worries about carbon dioxide retention. Some of the smartest people in the world wear masks all day for their jobs. So I wouldn't worry about it. It's going to be fine. And in fact, we have kids that wear masks all the time when they're sick, especially kids with cancer that can't take them off. And they grow up and thrive and do very, very well. I know that misinformation has been a huge effort for us, especially in the Homeland Security field, and the National Guard has helped us understand where that is coming from as well. And so we try to make sure that we are getting good information out in front of the public to make sure that you're not scared. There's lots of reasons to be scared right now. Masks are not one of them.
Rachel, can I, Dr. Kaufman, you were kind of nodding your head there that something came to mind. You want to share that?
Yeah, I would just like to reiterate and emphasize both Dr. Sullivan, Dr. Weaver, and of course, if she were here, Dr. Box's comments on this very topic. Masks do not lower your oxygen levels. They do not increase your carbon dioxide levels. Many surgeons, as Dr. Sullivan pointed out, physicians, you know, we wear masks in the emergency department sometimes continuously for 8 to 12 hours and are all doing just fine at the end of the day and maintaining ourselves as COVID-free. So wear your masks, wash your hands.
Thank you, Dr. Cole.
Thank you for joining today's briefing. Governor Holcomb's next briefing will be next Wednesday at 2:30 p.m. Eastern.